Welcome. Thank you for joining us here in this session. As we just heard, great innovations going on here, but also in the other places in Germany and all across the world. And we at Salesforce, we were a startup ourselves 15 years ago. And we have grown to be one of the top 10 IT players in the world. And we want to help startups to replicate that success. And when I work with startups in my job, I often get the same kind of questions from them. So you got this great tool, we all know about it, and we all want to buy it, but there's more than just selling than the tool. Can you also help us how to arrange our sales, how to build up our sales? Can you point us to the priorities in sales? Because we develop great products, but we were not born salespeople. So as we listen to our customers a lot, and we always try to serve them, we said, yes, we can help you. And this is one of the initiatives we're using to help startups to build out their business. And I want to start a topic by showing you this video of four German startup founders sharing their experiences with sales. So let's watch the film.
Mein Name ist Dominik Blank und ich bin Gründer und Geschäftsführer von POS Pulse. POS Pulse ist eine POS Analytics Firma, die Herstellern und Handelsunternehmen zu mehr Transparenz darüber verhilft, was draußen am Point of Sale, wo sie ihren Umsatz generieren, gerade tatsächlich passiert.
Mein Name ist Oliver Nützel, ich bin Geschäftsführer von Riondo. Mit Riondo digitalisieren wir die Freizeitbranche.
Ich bin Philipp, 30 Jahre alt. Ich habe 2008 mein erstes Unternehmen gegründet, habe dann die letzten 4 Jahre Zalando mit aufgebaut und investiere seit 1,5 Jahren in Startup-Unternehmen.
Ich heiße Olli Ruskopf, ich bin 31 und habe 2008 angefangen, bei Rocket Internet zu arbeiten. Ich habe mich dann Mitte letzten Jahres irgendwann entschieden, aus dieser Rocket-Welt zumindest ein Stück weit abzukapseln. Und daraus ist mein aktuelles Unternehmen entstanden. Es nennt sich die Sojan Vitamed Natur GmbH. Das ist ein Unternehmen, das Nahrungsergänzungsmittel vertreibt.
Gründer zu sein ist idealerweise eine Mischung aus Hobby und Topsport.
Man kann nicht erwarten, dass Gründen ein Lifestyle ist. Das ist einfach sehr harte Arbeit.
Ein außergewöhnlicher Gründer hat erstmal Biss, hat einen großen Traum, will optimalerweise ein großes Problem lösen mit seinem Unternehmen und hat Durchhaltevermögen.
Mich begeistert, dass ich mit einem wahnsinnig guten Team ein geniales Produkt auf den Markt bringen kann und wir was machen, was noch keiner vor uns gemacht hat.
Ich glaube, dass es extrem wichtig ist, gute Mitarbeiter früh auszuwählen und auch da einen sehr guten Draht immer zu diesen Mitarbeitern zu halten.
Ich glaube, dass man am Ende nie wirklich in Ideen investiert oder in Märkte investiert, sondern dass man immer in Personen investiert. Wir schauen sehr genau auch auf die Prozesse. Das heißt also, wie stellt sich ein Unternehmen vertriebsseitig auf? Wie macht das Unternehmen After Sales? Wie betreut das Unternehmen auch die Leads und auch die Kunden?
Experimente haben uns gezeigt, welche Route wir einschlagen mussten. Ich glaube, das ist auch der absolut richtige Weg. Also wirklich nicht sich intern lange zu unterhalten, sondern wirklich Experimente definieren und dann einfach mal machen.
Am Anfang versucht man seine Idee noch geheim zu halten. Also man will mit niemandem reden, weil man Angst hat, es wird kopiert. Ich glaube, diese Angst ist oftmals unbegründet, weil es hängt nicht nur an der Idee, sondern die Umsetzung ist eigentlich der Erfolgsfaktor. Und deswegen kann ich jedem nur empfehlen, möglichst früh mit möglichst vielen Menschen, die Ahnung haben, zu reden und dann auch auf deren Meinungen und Ideen zu hören.
Was bei Startups ja immer der Fall ist, dass versucht wird, zunächst immer erstmal alles ohne große externe Tools zu machen. Kosten zu sparen, effizient zu sein, nicht viel Geld auszugeben. Und Salesforce ist, denke ich, eines der Beispiele, wo es schon in einer relativ frühen Phase auch Sinn macht, in Tools zu investieren und damit eine Vertriebsstruktur auch zu professionalisieren.
Wir haben es versucht mit Excel. Ja. Das geht irgendwie, aber der Zeitaufwand, den ich nachher betreiben muss und die Informationen, die mir verloren gehen an der Stelle, das steht am Ende in keinem Verhältnis zu dem, was man wirklich an Kosten im Jahr dann nachher hat.
Wo sind wir gerade dran? Was haben wir gerade in der Pipe? Ich brauche so ein Dashboard, ich muss sehen, auch für Investoren, vielleicht sogar ein Reporting einzubinden, dass mir alles abgenommen wird sozusagen. Ja, also möglicherweise auch Workflows. Und das sind Sachen, die einfach in Salesforce möglich sind.
Das Wichtigste ist natürlich der Umsatz, den schauen wir uns täglich an. Dann natürlich die Vertriebsperformance im Team, was wir akquirieren, wie viele Anbieter wir haben und die Portfoliosteuerung. Dann schaue ich mir aber genauso die SEO-Kennzahlen an oder auch unseren IT-Backlog, weil mich letztendlich alles interessiert und ich diesen Gesamtüberblick haben möchte.
Die mehr, dass ein gutes Produkt sich von selbst verkauft, da glaube ich definitiv nicht dran. Ich glaube, jedes Unternehmen, was sich professionalisiert, braucht auch eine professionelle Vertriebsstruktur. Dabei helfen natürlich Tools, die das ermöglichen und die es auch für uns als Investoren oder als Business Angels transparent machen. Ein Rat ist, wirklich groß zu denken, darüber nachzudenken, welches Problem will ich wirklich lösen und dann sich nicht ablenken zu lassen.
Immer dranbleiben, ja, und zwar in zweierlei Hinsicht. Zum einen immer an das eigene Unternehmen glauben, immer weitermachen, selbst wenn man negatives Feedback kriegt.
Man muss dann eine dicke Haut haben. Also der Umsatz bzw. der Abschluss kommt meist mit dem 5., 6., 7. Kontakt. Ich nenne es immer being politely persistent. Meine Key Learnings im Vertrieb sind vor allem, dass Authentizität alles ist. Kunden müssen abnehmen, wer du bist, was du darstellst, dass du Integrität hast. Dazu gehört zum Beispiel auch manchmal zu sagen, weiß ich nicht.
Team oder Technik? Auf jeden Fall das Team, weil mit dem richtigen Team ist einem alles möglich.
Ein gutes Team bedeutet, man ist in der Lage, eine gute technische Lösung umzusetzen. Umgekehrt geht es nicht.
Definitiv Team und dann idealerweise so, dass das Team dann nachher die Technik auch bauen kann.
Selber bauen oder einkaufen haben wir uns bei Zalando häufig mit selber bauen beantwortet. Aber es kommt der Punkt, wo man die Entscheidung treffen muss, was ist eigentlich meine Kernkompetenz.
Bei meinem eigenen Produkt, also bei meiner Kernkompetenz, auf jeden Fall selber bauen. Alles andere, was nicht Kernkompetenz ist, einkaufen. Früher habe ich mich immer gefragt, im Konzern oder auch in der Beratung, ist es das überhaupt? Und seitdem ich im Startup bin, frage ich mich das nie. Also jeden Tag weiß ich, dass Startup, das was Eigenes, ein eigenes Unternehmen entwickeln, für mich genau das Richtige ist.
So, thank you. I hope you enjoyed the video. There were some technical difficulties in playing the video. We still went along with it. Tomorrow will be better, I promise. I had a lot of fun producing this video. I had the honor to interview these founders myself. It was a great day. We have hours of content. It was reduced in just 5-6 minutes. But now we're going to move on. Briefly about Salesforce, you know us for our CRM, our sales application, but today Salesforce is not only CRM in a sales automation sense, it's also about service, marketing, app development, analytics, and the community and the marketing clouds. But you know us for this product probably, our Sales Cloud. And exactly with this product, when I talk with startups about a solution, that's where they say, great, we want this, but help us organize this. How should I organize my sales? And to answer that question, I have Rijke here with me. And Rijke is the founder of Incubes. And Rijke is going to share his experiences, his learnings, being a founder himself, but also as a partner for startups in Berlin, how they build up and organize their sales and use Salesforce for that. Rijke, thank you for being here, and good luck.
Thank you, Mark. Dear ladies and gentlemen, hi guys, welcome. I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Rijke Treder. I'm co-founder and managing director of Incubes. We offer CRM integration, consultancy services, and also build software as a service products. On the left-hand side, you see a couple of those companies I had the pleasure to work with in the past. Today, I'm trying to cover basically two main topics, and the one is reaching product market fit, and the other one is opening revenue streams. Interesting thing, if you go to slideshare.net, and if you type in start selling, what comes out among the top list is a lot of presentations starting actually in the title with stop selling. And why is that? Look at the list. Those presentations carry names like stop selling and then start engaging, start relating, start teaching, start servicing. And what can we learn from that? A lot of people out there that obviously are expertise in that field of selling say that sales is about much more than just selling a product. It's actually about entering a relationship, engaging with someone and creating value. So today is basically not about sales or selling. It is more about serving a market. And that right from the beginning, we have to get straight. Sales is rather like an instrument to earn the opportunity to serve a relevant market. And what sales also is, it is a multi-directional channel to transport various things, such as the mission statement of your company, such as promises towards service or products you offer. It is a channel to transport information from you towards the customers and vice versa, of course, as well, to create and transport value, and of course to transport cash as well, because that at the very end defines whether you have the right to play on the market on the next day or not. Here's a mistake that a lot of startups make. They try to come up with everything, thousands of features and products, stuff everything in there just to avoid a situation in which the first customers say, no, we don't want to buy it because that one feature is missing. But that's usually the wrong approach. You need to find a niche, just like that seed that that saw a crack in the wall and saw an opportunity within that. And if you'd ask me what are the three characteristics a founder should bring, that is focus, that is perseverance, and that is to dare. And if you manage to do all those things and manage to make things that the market wants, then at the very end, you will end probably like this tree. This is a picture of me taken by my wife about 10 years ago that was pre-HD. And what you see is just the lower part of the roots of a giant tree that has overtaken the jungle. Here are some top reasons I gathered why founders actually hesitate to start selling. One is they ask themselves, should I share my secret? The answer is yes, because even though there is a slight chance that someone actually takes away your business idea and the once-in-a-lifetime chance, so to say, the chances are much higher that you gain a lot from that. You will learn early market feedback. You will earn early feedback on the features of your whole model. Doors will open. You will meet, partners as well, for instance. And some ask, will the market like my idea? Well, if your reason to be here mainly is to make serious business, then you will want to find out at one point anyway. So better make it your task to find out quite early. Some say, my product is so awesome, once it's ready, it will sell itself. No, it won't. Others say, we're just not ready yet. If we start now launching, we will terribly embarrass ourselves. Well, even though that might be true, better do that in the very beginning. There's a saying, and I believe it's true, if you start and you are not at least to a certain degree embarrassed by your very first offer, you just went to market too late. And one is, what if I fail? Well, it is always a question, how do you handle those situations of failure? If you learn from it and get up again and improve yourself, then it's all okay. And Reid Hoffman, the founder of LinkedIn, made that famous quote who said, starting up is basically like throwing yourself off a cliff and build a plane just on the way down. And that is, I believe, true. So the right order is ready, fire, and then aim. Because good is good enough. Just start. Don't think it over and over again. We tend to think over things again, but if we lack the proper base of information, overthinking leads to inaction, and that is always a problem. So basically, we do all that to get rid of the delta between self-perception and public perception, because you might think you do pretty good already. You need to find out what the others think. We know it's a lot about motivation. I'm going to skip this. Let's rather get hand-on. There are two fundamental anatomies I think you all should get familiar with if you're not yet already, and that is your funnel, how it works, and that is the decision-making process of your prospective clients. And this is how a funnel pretty much looks like. So you throw in a lot of leads, upstairs. You try to qualify those into prospects once they are. You need to engage with the individuals and start needs analysis. And you will finally identify certain opportunities. And once you did that, you make proposals and start closing the deal. So at the very top down there, you will have some customers. All that is called the sales cycle, and it obviously has different stages. And it is important to know that once you manage to convert customers, it is too late to just start thinking of where the new leads come from. Because just to give you an example, in IT consultancy, and that applies for many other branches as well, the average sales cycle is between 3 and 12 months. So if you start too late to start thinking about new leads, you will have a lot of weeks and months without any revenue coming in. So here are 6 keys to successful funnel management I gathered for you. And that is 1, never stop sourcing leads. Always keep the pipeline nicely stuffed. The second one is move them along or move them out. Don't be afraid. Some will drop out, and that is okay. That's a natural part of the process. There are certain prospects that are ready and want to make business with you, and you need to want to make business with them. And that there are others that are not. And number 3, determine where to best spend time on, where's the best return on time invested. Find that out. Where are you good? Where are you not so good? And if you're on the way, identify actually weaknesses that you have, get it fixed. Either hire someone who can do the job or engage a pro from an external source or partner up with someone. The 5th key to success from my experience is create a well-balanced pipeline. And that is not only in terms of skills, proper skills related to the proper cycle stages, but also in terms of quantities. That leads me to number 6, quantification, maybe the most important thing. Because especially in B2B, but that applies for B2C as well, but especially for B2B, it is incredibly important that you actually know the mechanic of your funnel. And in order to get better, you need numbers. You can only manage what you can measure. So here are some sales metrics I put together for you that we found out are usually considered interesting and important for startups. And that is obviously the number of new leads per month. It is also how much from month to month this number grows. It is the percentage of those leads qualifying into prospects, of that qualifying into closed deals. It is the average time it takes to close. That's the length of the sales cycle. It is the average cost per acquisition, and it is the average deal size of a new deal. So I told you there are 2 fundamental anatomies you need to get known to you. And the one thing was funnel, and the second is obviously decision-making process. What you see up here already is that the process is pretty complex. A lot of people are involved. A lot of different steps along that road are involved. And not only a lot of people are involved, but also a lot of roles. Roles those people play in the companies and within the buying process. It is always a team buy-in needed. Very, very seldomly ever a single buy-in. So, and the sad news about that is 78% of all companies first actively reach out to you when they already assembled a shortlist. Now, until here, it is pure chances whether you're on that list or not. So you should try to find out how to improve that probability. And the best way is actually to identify and engage with those individuals already beforehand, when they're still in the beginning of the decision-making process. And the important thing is try to create value for those people. Try to understand what are their needs, what are their objections, address them very early. And if you do that, and if you manage to create value to those people, you will dramatically increase the chance of not only actually landing on the shortlist, but landing pretty high up on it. I want to skip this. It's a very, very nice insight of some learnings I have taken from a picture postcard sent, but you all are very much invited to join me later at the Salesforce booth, and I will let you know those interesting things. So there are various good reasons to start early selling, and one of the most important, obviously, is that getting those first paying customers, and I'm not talking about friends, family, and fools, the first paying customers is incredibly important. It is incredibly important. It is your market proof. He has some very important factors. Several years longing analysis found out that impact B2B sales. One, obviously, is price. Okay, we all know that. Quality, yeah, sure. It is how much your solution is actually offering a total solution to an existing problem. But then look at that figure, 39%. It is about the effectiveness of a salesperson. And what is the learning from that? It is really, really interesting that so many startups spend most of the efforts in really trying to figure out what is the right quality for my product, make a lot of A/B testing about the pricing, and it's all good, but you need to train your salespeople, and you need to equip them with proper sales material as well, and you need to set up a good process for them, and you need to equip them with the proper tool, with the proper software that is capable of tracking all activities and doing analysis. So help those salespeople not being an administrative, chaotic, in a chaotic situation, help them sell. Because if those sales representatives are not able to transport the value that you create for those prospect clients, they won't be ready to pay. And here's the final concept I'd like to get you familiar with. You might know that already. It's between hunting and farming. Hunting pretty much means the activity to acquire a first-time customer. Obviously, that is not only very important, but it is one of the main activities for young startups. But you want to transition real quickly into a phase in which you do not only hunting, but also farming. That means to upsell or cross-sell to existing customer base. And the thing is, it is not only much, much cheaper to make a buyer a rebuyer than to acquire a buyer first time, it is much more profitable, but also it is much harder. How do you get that? How do you get that done? It is only possible by really knowing your prospects, knowing your clients, knowing what they want, knowing their needs, and how to address them properly. And that, again, you need a slick process for, and also a software that helps you in that. So one of the last things I want to give you, it's a takeaway. I know you guys love that sort of information. These are some growth hacking essentials I'd like to share with you. One thing is get field reports early in the process. Try to understand the information you get, plan measures, and implement those things. Second thing is set goals. It is important to always work towards goals. Establish routines that help you achieving those goals set, and track the progress. If necessary, refine. You all know probably the Pareto principle. If not, get reading. It is about the 80-20 rule. That means that basically that 20% of the effort bring an 80% of the result. Another important thing is it is wise to over nurture and over service your first few customers, because those are multiples for you. If they think you're bringing service and you do your job very well, they will tell others, and that will help you to get the whole machine going. Another thing is lower the final buying hurdles. Interesting case is Hare Krishna. I don't have to do anything with them, but what they did is they managed to collect millions and millions of dollars all around the world, and their strategy was giving away for free just flowers, and afterwards ask for a donation, and that worked pretty well. Think about it. Sell with the purpose of making them want to hire you. Make it just incredibly good. And maybe the most important thing, let your happiest clients become your best sales machine. This is the executive team at Incubes. I'm very happy if you guys want to reach out to me, make photos of the slide. You're very much invited to do so. I send you the slide deck, even an extended version of the slide deck if you want. Get in touch with us via email or via Twitter. Or also happy to invite you to the Salesforce stand where you will find us today, tomorrow, and on Wednesday. Thank you very much.